I'm Petty Officer Christina Brockman. Join Staff Sergeant Jimmy Williams and me on Navy Marine Corps News. This week, we celebrate the Navy's 225th birthday in San Francisco, where the city by the bay hosts its 15th annual Fleet Week. We'll introduce you to a sailor who took advantage of a new program that makes it easier for service members to obtain a U.S. citizenship. And we'll see how sailors navigate submarines through the harbor and out to sea. These stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News.
This week on Navy Marine Corps News, we celebrate the Navy's 225th birthday in San Francisco, where the city by the bay hosts its 15th annual Fleet Week. We'll introduce you to a sailor who took advantage of a new program that makes it easier for service members to obtain U.S. citizenship. And we'll see how sailors navigate submarines through the harbor and out to sea. These stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News. Hi, and welcome to our special birthday edition of Navy Marine Corps News. I'm Staff Sergeant Jimmy Williams.
And I'm Petty Officer Christina Brockman. As you can see, we're on location to celebrate our Navy's 225th birthday with the fleet.
We're coming to you from San Francisco, where the city by the bay is holding its 15th annual Fleet Week.
And this is one of the city's well-known landmarks, Alcatraz Island. Check out the view of the ships.
We've got lots to show you here, but before we get started, let's go back to our Washington, D.C. studio and Chief Monica Hallman with some late-breaking news.
Thanks, Staff Sergeant. The Secretary of the Navy, along with the Chief of Naval Operations and Commandant of the Marine Corps, announced that Electronic Data Systems Corporation of Plano, Texas, will build the new Navy Marine Corps intranet. The $6.9 billion contract will create an intranet that will link sailors and Marines around the world.
By uniting our information systems, we create a united department of the Navy that will be better able to perform its missions in the world at large. This is a Navy and Marine Corps intranet. The two services will be intimately linked in ways they are not now.
The Navy Marine Corps intranet will replace many independent networks ashore with one secure network. It will also provide voice, video, and data communication services for all personnel in the Navy and Marine Corps, including deployed forces. That's the news in Washington. Now back to Fleet Week in San Francisco.
Thanks, Chief.
Right behind us, you can see the parade of ships as they make their way beneath the Golden Gate Bridge and into San Francisco Bay.
Here's Chief Tom Crydell with the highlights of this year's Fleet Week.
10 ships of the Navy's Third Fleet sailed below the Golden Gate Bridge and into San Francisco Bay to begin the 15th annual Fleet Week. Spectators and a harbor full of boats welcomed the parade of ships as they sailed past Municipal Pier and Alcatraz Island.
I've seen a lot of naval movies and aircraft carriers on TV. I just definitely wanted to see them, I mean, in person.
It was pretty exciting. I was excited to see it. I saw it with my kids. I could tell they had their binoculars up and they were looking at all the ships and they were asking me what kinds they were.
But the ships weren't the only draw.
The turnout here was pretty amazing. I mean, obviously there's a lot of people here that respect what they do and, you know, just really want to know more about, you know, the daily lives of a sailor.
And learning about sailors is what local residents did when they toured USS Constellation. More than 30,000 lined the city's Embarcadero for a chance to get a closer look at the aircraft carrier. And once aboard, they say the wait was worth it.
It's incredible. It's an amazing thing to see how all these things function together and everything has a purpose. I think it's important to see that it's people behind all the machines and the armaments, that the Navy really is people. But I know that they're out there doing their job and that it really is important to us all.
I think it's important so that the public can see what the ships are like, what the personnel on the ships do. We hear so much about it on TV or you hear about it, you know, in the different communications, but you don't actually get to see it, and it gives them the opportunity to be able to see what the military actually go through on a day-to-day basis.
And that sentiment made the sailors giving the tours feel appreciated.
It makes me feel a great deal of pride just because, you know, the people actually come out and they shake your hands and they tell you, you know, how great of a job you're doing and they appreciate what you're doing for them. And those are the type of things that make me feel good about being a sailor, being out to sea.
But the action wasn't limited to the piers. The Blue Angels took to the skies to wow the crowd with a demonstration of their skills.
they never cease to amaze me. I'm just awestruck. It just runs chills up you, and it's just amazing. I can't believe it. I'm totally afraid of airplanes, but they could take me up in the air any day.
After an air show, including their amazing acrobatics, the Blue Angels inspired even the youngest of spectators.
The Navy's cool.
From San Francisco, Chief Tom Cradell, Navy Marine Corps News.
This is really a great place to see the parade of ships and the San Francisco skyline.
Not to mention the Golden Gate Bridge behind us. Never thought I'd be doing Navy Marine Corps News from Alcatraz.
No kidding. Now, many of us have heard stories and seen movies about Alcatraz, but not many of us have taken a tour of this place they call The Rock. For 29 years, Alcatraz was America's premier maximum security prison. Being one of the nation's most unruly inmates would buy you a ticket here. Alcatraz is a place of contradictions, with a grim past and an enduring future as one of San Francisco's most prominent landmarks and tourist attractions. Throughout its history, Alcatraz was home to more than 1,500 criminals. And contrary to popular belief, only a handful of Alcatraz inmates were notorious. Topping the list of corrupt criminals was Al Capone. Capone spent 4.5 years here, some of that time in cell B206. For years, many people have wondered, has anyone ever successfully escaped from The Rock? Well, the answer is simple. Who knows? Records show 36 inmates tried to escape. 22 of them were recaptured. 7 were shot and killed, 2 drowned, and 5 are unaccounted for. Probably the most violent escape attempt on Alcatraz happened in 1946. A couple of inmates overpowered a prison guard and seized a variety of weapons. A bloody battle ensued between the inmates and prison guards. It was so bad, the warden sent out an emergency call to the Marines stationed at Treasure Island, the Navy, the Coast Guard, and San Francisco Police. The Marines rounded up all the prisoners who were not in the battle and held them here in the prison yard. The Navy and Coast Guard had heavily armed planes and boats circling the island. After a day and a half, the battle was over. With the help of the Navy and Marine Corps, prison guards regained control of Alcatraz. Alcatraz is now home to thousands of seagulls. In fact, the spot where we're standing is open exclusively to the birds about 9 months a year.
Luckily for us, they've headed south for the winter. There are 10 U.S. Navy ships taking part in this year's Fleet Week, including USS Constellation, Boxer, and Coronado.
USS Coronado, as the Third Fleet flagship, is currently outfitted with some new high-tech gear that will help the commander monitor and direct battles.
Petty Officer Miranda Williams of our San Diego Bureau is aboard Coronado for the story.
In a dedication ceremony on board USS Coronado during San Francisco's Fleet Week, Secretary of the Navy Richard Danzig designated Third Fleet's command ship the Navy's first sea-based battle lab. By using the latest in technology for the fleet, SecNav says Coronado is playing a vital role in our Navy's future.
In terms of how we work, this emphasizes something that's very fundamental, which is that the Navy is on the cutting edge of American technology. Realistically, we've always been a technological service. Our sailors and Marines, as a result of this, are being trained in the most sophisticated kinds of applications.
But USS Coronado didn't always test top-of-the-line technology. It was when the ship was slated for decommissioning several years ago that the idea for the sea-based battle lab was born. The new technology on board includes this knowledge wall that allows users to see everything from detailed maps to CNN. Sailors are excited to be a part of the program and know their jobs have a direct impact on their shipmates in the fleet.
As a technician, we get to play around with all the new toys. We learn new technologies as they're brought on board so that we can attain our goal, which is to bring new systems online, to test them on this platform, and to get them out into the fleet.
Thanks to these dedicated COM 3rd Fleet and Coronado sailors, the innovations of the new millennium will be changing the way the shipboard sailor of the future does business. Aboard USS Coronado, Petty Officer Miranda Williams, Navy Marine Corps News.
Sailors on ships and submarines around the fleet will soon be sleeping better at night thanks to improved mattresses.
Navy Secretary Richard Danzig started a $36 million program to replace the Navy's existing foam bedding with new inner spring mattresses.
The submarine USS Norfolk has already received the new mattresses, and other ships and subs will get them as they get closer to deployment or supplies become available.
Stay right there, because when we come back, we'll take you on Liberty in San Francisco.
Don't go away.
We'll be right back.
2.25 centuries. Happy birthday, Navy. We talk an awful lot with each other about the responsibilities of our jobs, and we emphasize them to the larger public in an effort to get support. The demands of being everywhere, all over the globe, representing America's interest, being always there for America, are very great. Living up to our standards is a challenging thing. The goals and ideals of honor, courage, and commitment are difficult to achieve. But a birthday is a day for celebration, and I think we should pause for a moment to recognize what a joy it is to be in the Navy, how much we value one another, that we're all, in fact, here as a matter of choice, that the honor and the courage and commitment that we bring to bear makes us better people, and we're happy to do it, that the camaraderie we have amongst each other gives us a sense of solidarity and reward that transcends almost anything you can get in most other professions and other institutions. Let's make of this birthday an occasion for celebrating the fact that we're together in this Navy. Congratulations, happy birthday. Let's enjoy it.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News.
Landing aircraft aboard aircraft carriers or aboard naval air stations is a team effort, requiring a high level of skill from both pilots and air traffic controllers.
Thanks to some highly effective training in Pensacola, Florida, Navy and Marine Corps air traffic controllers are among the best in the world. Petty Officer Mike Gleckler files this report.
Although many of these sailors have only been in the Navy a short time, they are already being trained for a major role in naval aviation. Their training uses the latest technology.
It used to be that you would be walking around a room with wooden airplanes. Here, as far as the simulation is concerned, it's all just like a ship right now. Everything that you would see in here can actually happen when you get out to the fleet.
The importance of technologically advanced training is paramount to these controllers of the sky because the lives of pilots are in their hands.
There's occasion where the pilots can be their own eyes, but we still have to bring them down to the ground. We have to put them on the deck. So I think we rate very highly as far as operational importance.
Operational importance that at sea includes the safety of the air wing.
We support the air wing from when they launch to when they land, the last plane on deck.
While the formal training of these students is in simulated towers or carrier air traffic control centers, the actual training is in molding the sailor for professionalism.
They're graded from the first day they walk in. As far as uniforms are concerned, appearance, all that's taken into consideration when they step foot in that door. And then we start critiquing them as far as written test and OJT on-the-job training. Nothing but the best comes out of the school.
While technology is helping the sailors of today get a grip on tomorrow, students at the Naval Air Technical Training Center are learning valuable lessons about themselves.
It's the best thing that I've ever done in my life because I really didn't accomplish anything. Going through high school and stuff, I had that I don't care attitude, and then joining the Navy and being able to have a good job like this, just, it's exciting, it's thrilling.
Petty Officer Mike Gleckler, Navy Marine Corps News.
As you can hear, Fleet Week is in full swing, and one of the best things about any Fleet Week is going out and meeting the people who live there and experience a great city like San Francisco.
And the locals always go out of their way to welcome sailors and Marines in town.
Petty Officer Nico Melendez caught up with some sailors for a day on the town.
Trying to decide what sights to see in the city by the bay may be a hard decision for many sailors, but for Petty Officers Donald Wampler and Yesenia Rivera, the choices were simple.
Pretty wild.
From the Golden Gate Bridge to Chinatown, we toured, took pictures, and shopped, making memories to last a lifetime.
I'll be able to take this with me for the rest of my life and be able to pass it down to my children.
While visiting the Golden Gate Bridge, these sailors marveled at the technology it took to put the 63-year-old massive steel together.
Right. This thing is enormous.
The Golden Gate Bridge was one of my favorites. I never thought I'd be able to stand on it, let alone walk on it. I've seen it on movies, Full House, everywhere.
Our next stop, San Francisco's world-famous cable cars. Traveling up and down Hyde Street, these sailors experienced the streets as San Franciscans have for decades. Yep. And got a unique look at the city's beautiful bay.
These are very steep hills, aren't they, guys?
Riding the cable cars was, I think, one of the coolest things we did today.
Sailors visiting San Francisco this week during Fleet Week not only had a chance to visit some world-famous landmarks, they had a chance to eat some of the best food on the West Coast, including clam chowder in the sourdough bread bowl, just like this.
If it's shrimp, crabs, clams, or oysters that you are in search of, San Francisco's Fisherman's Wharf is the place to go. Crab stands line the pier, welcoming travelers to taste the freshest seafood available on the West Coast. Our visiting sailors even took a taste of some crab, and a crab tried to take a taste of one of our sailors. And seafood isn't the only thing available for visitors along the piers. There are hundreds of California sea lions to see, incredible views, and several street performers. And since baseball fever hit the Bay Area so hard this month, both the Oakland A's and the San Francisco Giants making the playoffs, our sailors felt the need to visit Pac Bell Park, one of the newest ballparks in the major leagues, where they were welcomed in grand style.
Hi, Jordan. My name's Donald.
Another can't miss, of course, is Chinatown. Established in the 1850s, today Chinatown is home to more than 10,000 of San Francisco's residents. Streets are lined with restaurants and stores, all of which provide sailors a great opportunity for shopping. Of course, no matter where you go in San Francisco, sailors are very obvious and easy to find. The white uniforms always draw a crowd.
We received a very warm reception from the people around here. They were very nice. They talked to you. Everybody wanted to see you, greet you, take pictures with you.
From San Francisco, Petty Officer Nico Melendez, Navy Marine Corps News.
I've had a chance to look around in the last few days, and this city is an awesome place to visit.
Now, did you try the chowder and the sourdough like J.O. wanted?
Not yet, but maybe right after we're done here. For sailors and Marines who aren't American citizens, the road to citizenship used to take a long time.
But not anymore. The U.S. Immigration and Naturalization Service has set up a central military processing unit that reduces the time it takes for military people to achieve citizenship from years to months.
And recently, the first sailor to benefit from the new program was sworn in. Seaman Jennifer Smith was there.
There are more than 12,000 enlisted sailors who are not American citizens, but now there are two less after SK-3 Stacy Wright, who originally hailed from Chile, and HM-2 Guillermo Patino, a former Colombian citizen, took the oath of allegiance earlier this month at the U.S. Navy Memorial. SK-3 Wright processed her citizenship application using the traditional method, which could take up to 2 years to complete. HM-2 Patino used the new Central Military Processing Unit to process his application.
It's taken me 4 months from the very beginning till now to have my citizenship completed.
The new streamlined application process is available to all permanent resident sailors and Marines who have served at least 3 years of honorable active duty service.
I've been waiting for a long time for this to happen, this day. I actually belong to this country that I love so much and that I defend.
The Navy has been very good to me, and I've recently been accepted to medical school in Chicago, and I've been applying for a Navy military scholarship.
Seaman Jennifer Smith, Navy Marine Corps News.
The Marine Corps needs volunteer instructors for the 2001 Presidential Classroom beginning January 18th.
Presidential Classroom was founded in 1968. Its mission is to teach high school juniors and seniors about the government and the political process.
This program is open to all senior NCOs and officers with at least an undergraduate degree.
You can find out more about the Presidential Classroom on the internet at www.presidentialclassroom.org.
It's a great chance for you to serve as a role model, especially if you like government and politics.
Stay right there, because when we return, we'll take you aboard a submarine and show you how they handle the challenge of navigating the harbor.
We'll be right back.
Happy birthday, shipmates. McPon Hurt here. This week, we celebrate 225 years of our amazingly proud naval heritage. It's nearly impossible to fully fathom the sacrifices millions of Americans have endured to build this heritage. However, we must not only be aware of our history, but ensure that our every action furthers our traditions of pride and professionalism. How you serve our Navy will write your own chapter in the heritage our future sailors will build upon. It's our goal that they must reach higher than ever to improve on the heritage we leave them. It's no secret that we serve in the greatest Navy ever. My challenge to you is to make sure that the Navy we turn over to our grandchildren will meet similar, unprecedented standards. October 13, 1775 is a day that forever changed the world. Our Navy was born. Happy birthday, shipmates, and I'll see you about the fleet.
The birthday edition of Navy Marine Corps News from Alcatraz Island.
When you think of submarines, you usually imagine them in the middle of the ocean, hidden hundreds of feet below the ocean surface.
But before they can get there, they have to travel out of the harbor, on the surface.
Petty Officer Chris Robinson of our San Diego Bureau joined the sailors of USS Jefferson City for Sea and Anchor Detail.
The crew of USS Jefferson City prepares to get underway. They know once they get to sea, they'll have room to negotiate the waters. But before they cast off the last line, they man their stations to face the first real challenge of their underway period, getting out of the harbor.
We're navigating through a real small channel. Slightest error, we can run aground. It kind of puts a lot of pressure on you.
These sailors thrive under the pressure. They use new and old seamanship tools and skills to guide the boat out of San Diego Harbor. Global positioning systems, sonar, and charts help carry them out to sea.
So I need to go from here to there. I need to know what course and speed to make it there.
Yes, sir. The hub of this navigation is in Jefferson City's control room, but they count on a pilot on the bridge to lead them out. As the sub passes buoys and visual markers, the pilot relays that info to the con. But he's not alone. He gets help from the sonar techs.
Speed, 6 knots.
My sole purpose, the biggest purpose is to save your ship. I keep us from getting run over. Everybody else's life in your hands when you're doing it.
Jefferson City finally clears the harbor and then does what it does best.
Dive, dive.
They've reached the open sea, where they'll take the sub on its mission, testing the submarine with sea trials. They'll push the sub's ability and the crew's experience until they've reached the objective. An outstanding sea trial and a submarine ready for deployment. From San Diego, Petty Officer Chris Robinson, Navy Marine Corps News.
As the Navy celebrates 225 years, the newest ship in the Arleigh Burke class is about to celebrate its first day in the Navy.
And during their recent shakedown cruise, her crew took the ship out to sea to flex the muscle of the high-tech warfighting equipment this modern warship carries. Corporal Scott Pesca gives us a look.
The Roosevelt, named for both Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt, put all its systems to the test in the weeks leading up to its commissioning ceremony. Sea trials gave the crew a chance to test the ship's maneuvering and engineering capabilities. The newest Arleigh Burke-class destroyer has the latest technology available, making it a superior warship. Roosevelt is outfitted with the Aegis combat system, standard anti-aircraft missiles, and Tomahawk cruise missiles. The ship is also the first Arleigh Burke-class destroyer with two SH-60B Lamps III helicopters. The two helos will enhance mission capability. Inside, operations specialists work on a brand new plotting system.
Well, the new system I work on is the Integrated Navigational Tactical Plotting System, or otherwise known as INTIPS. It's a great system. It allows us to track contacts that we may find by computer. It makes our job a little easier. By doing that, we don't have to plot our own course and speed or anything like that. It's linked up with the ship, so that's automatic.
The ship's all-steel construction and damage control features enhance its safety and survivability. Damage controlmen are equipped with the self-contained breathing apparatus, which is worn by civilian firefighters. The SCBA is lighter and uses rechargeable cylinders, eliminating hazardous waste material.
Sailors on board also got an unexpected innovation in their berthing areas. When the lounge area was eliminated to fit more racks, a sailor suggested small drop-down TVs be installed in each rack. The command thought it was a feasible solution, and so each sailor has a personal TV, which programs command information in addition to entertainment. The Roosevelt, equipped, tested, and manned with a dedicated crew, is ready for the fleet. Corporal Scott Pesca, Navy Marine Corps News.
The Roosevelt will be commissioned October 14th in Mayport, Florida, where it will be homeported.
And now it's time for Cyber Sailor.
This week he reflects on our 225 years of history with a virtual tour of the Naval Historical Center.
As we move ahead into the 21st century, technology in the Navy is changing every day, but it's important to keep in touch with our naval heritage. And this week, I'll show you a great way to do just that.
History.Navy.mil opens a huge window to the past and our heritage as sailors with facts, photos, and maritime history. The easiest way to begin is through frequently asked questions. This FAQ link is set up like a site index. You can choose from a huge list of topics. For example, scroll down and click on wars and conflicts to learn the Navy's role in every war since the Revolution. You can brush up on your general knowledge of the Navy by viewing traditions of the Naval Service. Here you can find out everything from the origin of our modern Navy flag to why a ship is referred to as she.
And what about some of the terms and customs that are still carried out today? Terms like shellback or plank owner. And how have our uniforms changed over the years?
You'll find these answers under Naval Uniforms. You can view current uniform regulations and learn about the history of the uniforms themselves. This uniform section also contains up-to-date pictures and descriptions of every ribbon and medal in the Navy. For something a little different, click on Crossing the Line to read about some of the Navy's unofficial titles and certificates you can earn while serving in the fleet.
History.Navy.mil is the site to learn about our Navy's history and develop a real sense of appreciation for the progress we've made in 225 years. If you have any questions or if there are any other sites you'd like me to share with the fleet, send them to me, cybersailor@mediasend.navy.mil. I'm Airman Chris Reynolds, Navy Marine Corps News.
Cyber Sailor showed only a small part of the site, so go there and check it out. There's lots of history to learn.
Well, that's the show for this week. As always, we'd like to hear your thoughts and ideas about Navy Marine Corps News. So call our feedback line or send us an email.
The number and address are coming up in a minute. Hey, before we go, we'd like to thank the National Park Service, Ranger Nick Lavrov, and everyone here at Alcatraz for all their help with our special Navy birthday show.
We'd also like to say hello and thanks for watching to our viewers in nearby Walnut Creek, California, who watch us every week on TCI Cable Channel 6.
We leave you this week with a look at the Navy, past and present. Happy birthday, Navy.
Thanks, and have a great week.
USS Jefferson City prepares to get underway. They know once they get to sea, they'll have room to negotiate the waters. But before they cast off the last line, they man their stations to face one of the toughest parts of this underway, getting out of the harbor.
We're navigating through a real small channel. Slightest error, we can run aground. Kind of puts a lot of pressure on you.
These sailors thrive under the pressure. They use new and old seamanship tools and skills to guide the boat out of San Diego Harbor. Global positioning systems, sonar, and charts help carry them out to sea.
So I need to go from here to there. I need to know what course and speed to make it there.
Yes, sir. The hub of this navigation is in Jefferson City's control room. But they count on a pilot on the bridge to lead them out. As the sub passes buoys and visual markers, the pilot relays that info to the con. But he's not alone. He gets help from the sonar techs.
My sole purpose, the biggest purpose, is safety of ship. I keep this from getting run over. So you've got the guys, everybody else's life in your hands when you're doing it.
Jefferson City finally clears the harbor, and then does what it does best.
Dive! Dive!
They've reached the open sea, where they'll take the sub on its mission, testing the submarine with sea trials. Steep angles and dangles, pitches and rolls are part of this challenge. They'll push the sub's ability and the crew's experience until they've reached the objective, an outstanding sea trial and a submarine ready for deployment. From San Diego, Petty Officer Chris Robinson, Navy Marine Corps News.
The Roosevelt, named for both Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt, put all its systems to the test in the weeks leading up to its commissioning ceremony. Sea trials gave the crew a chance to test the ship's maneuvering and engineering capabilities. The newest Arleigh Burke-class destroyer has the latest technology available, making it a superior warship. Roosevelt is outfitted with the Aegis combat system and anti-aircraft Tomahawk cruise missiles. The ship is also the first destroyer with two SH-60B helos with LAMPS 3 electronics. The two helos will enhance mission capability. Inside, operations specialists working on a brand new plotting system.
Well, the new system I work on is the Integrated Navigational Tactical Plotting System, or otherwise known as INTIPS. It's a great system. It allows us to track contacts that we may find by computer. It makes our job a little easier. By doing that, we don't have to plot our own course and speed or anything like that. It's linked up with the ship, so that's automatic.
The ship's all-steel construction and damage control features enhance its safety and survivability. Damage controlmen are equipped with the self-contained breathing apparatus, which is worn by civilian firefighters. The SCBA is lighter and uses rechargeable cylinders, eliminating hazardous waste material. Sailors on board also got an unexpected innovation in their berthing areas. When the lounge area was eliminated to fit more racks, a sailor suggested small drop-down TVs be installed in each rack. The command thought it was a feasible solution, and so each sailor has a personal TV, which programs command information in addition to entertainment. The Roosevelt, equipped, tested, and manned with a dedicated crew, is ready for the fleet. Corporal Scott Pesca, Navy Marine Corps News.
Thanks, Staff Sergeant. The Secretary of the Navy, along with the Chief of Naval Operations and Commandant of the Marine Corps, announced that Electronic Data Systems Corporation of Plano, Texas, will build the new Navy Marine Corps intranet. The $6.9 billion contract will create an intranet that will link sailors and Marines around the world.
By uniting our information systems, we create a united department of the Navy that will be better able to perform its missions in the world at large. This is a Navy and Marine Corps intranet. The two services will be intimately linked in ways they are not now.
The Navy Marine Corps intranet will replace many independent networks ashore with one secure network. It will also provide voice, video, and data communication services for all personnel in the Navy and Marine Corps, including deployed forces. That's the news in Washington. Now back to Fleet Week in San Francisco.
In a dedication ceremony on board USS Coronado during San Francisco's Fleet Week, Secretary of the Navy Richard Danzig designated Third Fleet's command ship the Navy's first sea-based battle lab.
By using the latest in technology for the fleet, SecNav says Coronado is playing a vital role in our Navy's future.
In terms of how we work, this emphasizes something that's very fundamental, which is that the Navy is on the cutting edge of American technology. Realistically, we've always been a technological service. Our sailors and Marines, as a result of this, are being trained in the most sophisticated kinds of applications.
But USS Coronado didn't always test top-of-the-line technology. It was when the ship was slated for decommissioning several years ago that the idea for the Sea-Based Battle Lab was born. The new technology on board includes this knowledge wall that allows users to see everything from detailed maps to CNN. Sailors are excited to be a part of the program and know their jobs have a direct impact on their shipmates in the fleet.
As a technician, we get to play around with all the new toys. We learn new technologies as they're brought on board so that we can attain our goal, which is to bring new systems online, to test them on this platform, and to get them out into the fleet.
Thanks to these dedicated Comm 3rd Fleet and Coronado sailors, the innovations of the new millennium will be changing the way the shipboard sailor of the future does business. Aboard USS Coronado, Petty Officer Miranda Williams, Navy Marine Corps News.
Trying to decide what sights to see in the city by the bay may be a hard decision for many sailors, but for Petty Officers Donald Wampler and Yesenia Rivera, the choices were simple.
Pretty wild.
From the Golden Gate Bridge to Chinatown, we toured, took pictures, and shopped, making memories to last a lifetime.
I'll be able to take this with me for the rest of my life and be able to pass it down to my children.
While visiting the Golden Gate Bridge, these sailors marveled at the technology it took to put the 63-year-old mass of steel together.
Right. This thing is enormous.
The Golden Gate Bridge was one of my favorites. I never thought I'd be able to stand on it, let alone walk on it. I've seen it on movies, Full House, everywhere.
Our next stop, San Francisco's world-famous cable cars. Traveling up and down Hyde Street, these sailors experienced the streets as San Franciscans have for decades and got a unique look at the city's beautiful bay.
These are very steep hills, aren't they, guys? Riding the cable cars was, I think, one of the coolest things we did today.
Sailors visiting San Francisco this week during Fleet Week not only had a chance to visit some world-famous landmarks, they had a chance to eat some of the best food on the West Coast, including clam chowder in the sourdough bread bowl, just like this. If it's shrimp, crabs, clams, or oysters that you are in search of, San Francisco's Fisherman's Wharf is the place to go. Crab stands line the pier welcoming travelers to taste the freshest seafood available on the West Coast. Our visiting sailors even took a taste of some crab, and a crab tried to take a taste of one of our sailors. And seafood isn't the only thing available for visitors along the piers. There are hundreds of California sea lions to see, incredible views, and several street performers. And since baseball fever hit the Bay Area so hard this month, both the Oakland A's and the San Francisco Giants making the playoffs, our sailors felt the need to visit Pac Bell Park, one of the newest ballparks in the major leagues, where they were welcomed in grand style.
Hi, Jordan. My name's Donald.
Another can't miss, of course, is Chinatown. Established in the 1850s, today Chinatown is home to more than 10,000 of San Francisco's residents. Streets are lined with restaurants and stores, all of which provide sailors a great opportunity for shopping. Of course, no matter where you go in San Francisco, sailors are very obvious and easy to find. The white uniforms always draw a crowd.
We received a very warm reception from the people around here. They were very nice. They talked to you. Everybody wanted to see you, greet you, take pictures with you.
From San Francisco, Petty Officer Nico Melendez, Navy Marine Corps News.
2 1/4 centuries. Happy birthday, Navy. We talk an awful lot with each other about the responsibilities of our jobs, and we emphasize them to the larger public in an effort to get support. The demands of being everywhere, all over the globe, representing America's interest, being always there for America, are very great. Living up to our standards is a challenging thing. The goals and ideals of honor, courage, and commitment are difficult to achieve. But a birthday is a day for celebration, and I think we should pause for a moment to recognize what a joy it is to be in the Navy, how much we value one another, that we're all, in fact, here as a matter of choice, that the honor and the courage and commitment that we bring to bear makes us better people and we're happy to do it, that the camaraderie we have amongst each other gives us a sense of solidarity and reward that transcends almost anything you can get in most other professions and other institutions. Let's make of this birthday an occasion for celebrating the fact that we're together in this Navy. Congratulations, happy birthday. Let's enjoy it.
The beginning of the school year also marked the beginning of this year's Adopt-a-School partnership between USS Kitty Hawk sailors and second grade students from Sullivan School in Yokosuka, Japan.
I plan on being a teacher when I get out of the Navy, so I thought it would be something fun that I would enjoy.
I thought it was a very good idea. Me personally, I love kids. I got one of my own, I got a 4-year-old.
Activities planned for the year include field trips and special projects both in and out of the classroom. And even if the sailors deploy, the partnership still continues.
Both the teacher and the ship has email. They're also working with the kids and learning computers now, so the children are able to email us, which is a great experience, learning experience for them as well. And we send postcards from our different ports. When we send from the other countries and stuff, they usually get out a globe or a map of some sort and look and see where we are. That's also a learning experience. Everything that we do, pretty much, they learn from it, and we learn from as well.
I'm excited about it. I really am. I'm glad to be here.
From Yokosuka, Japan, Petty Officer Rita Chadwick, Navy Marine Corps News.
There are more than 12,000 enlisted sailors who are not American citizens, but now there are two less after SK-3 Stacy Wright, who originally hailed from Chile, and HM-2 Guillermo Patino, a former Colombian citizen, took the oath of allegiance earlier this month at the U.S. Navy Memorial. SK-3 Wright processed her citizenship application using the traditional method, which could take up to 2 years to complete. HM-2 Patino used the new Central Military Processing Unit to process his application.
It's taken me 4 months from the very beginning till now to have my citizenship completed.
The new streamlined application process is available to all permanent resident sailors and Marines who have served at least 3 years of honorable active duty service.
I've been waiting for a long time for this to happen, this day. I actually belong to this country that I love so much and that I defend.
The Navy has been very good to me, and I've recently been accepted to medical school in Chicago, and I've been applying for a Navy military scholarship.
Seaman Jennifer Smith, Navy Marine Corps News.
Just out of high school and barely able to vote, these young sailors come to Pensacola to learn how to be air traffic controllers for the Navy's aircraft carriers and air stations. Today's sailors can expect some pretty realistic training based on actual events and scenarios.
It used to be that you'd be walking around a room with wooden airplanes. Here, as far as the simulation is concerned, it's all just like a ship right now. Everything that you would see in here can actually happen when you get out to the fleet.
The importance of technologically advanced training is paramount to these controllers of the sky because the lives of pilots are in their hands.
There's occasion where the pilots have can be their own eyes, but we still have to bring them down to the ground. We have to put them on the deck. So I think we rate very highly as far as operational importance.
Operational importance that at sea includes the safety of the air wing.
We support the air wing from when they launch to when they land, the last plane on deck.
For professionalism.
They're graded from the first day they walk in. As far as uniforms are concerned, appearance, all that's taken into consideration when they step foot in that door. And then we start critiquing them as far as written test and OJT on the job training. Nothing but the best comes out of the school.
While technology is helping the sailors of today get a grip on tomorrow, students at the Naval Air Technical Training Center are learning valuable lessons about themselves and the skies they control.
It's the best thing that I've ever done in my life because I really didn't accomplish anything. Going through high school and stuff, I had that I don't care attitude. And then joining the Navy and being able to have a good job like this, just, it's exciting, it's thrilling.
Petty Officer Mike Gleckler, Navy Marine Corps News.
For 29 years, Alcatraz was America's premier maximum security prison. Being one of the nation's most unruly inmates would buy you a ticket here. Alcatraz is a place of contradictions. With a grim past and an enduring future, it's one of San Francisco's most prominent landmarks and tourist attractions.
Throughout its history, Alcatraz was home to more than 1,500 criminals. And contrary to popular belief, only a handful of Alcatraz inmates were notorious. Topping the list of corrupt criminals was Al Capone. Capone spent 4.5 years here, some of that time in cell B206.
For years, many people have wondered, has anyone ever successfully escaped from the Rock? Well, the answer is simple. Who knows? Records show 36 inmates tried to escape. 22 of them were recaptured. 7 were shot and killed, 2 drowned, and 5 are unaccounted for.
Probably the most violent escape attempt on Alcatraz happened in 1946. A couple of inmates overpowered a prison guard and seized a variety of weapons. A bloody battle ensued between the inmates and prison guards. It was so bad, the warden sent out an emergency call to the Marines stationed at Treasure Island, the Navy, the Coast Guard, and San Francisco Police. The Marines rounded up all the prisoners who were not in the battle and held them here in the prison yard. The Navy and Coast Guard had heavily armed planes and boats circling the island. After a day and a half, the battle was over. With the help of the Navy and Marine Corps, prison guards regained control of Alcatraz.
Ten ships of the Navy's Third Fleet sailed below the Golden Gate Bridge and into San Francisco Bay to begin the 15th annual Fleet Week. Spectators in a harbor full of boats welcomed the parade of ships as they sailed past Municipal Pier and Alcatraz Island.
I've seen a lot of naval movies and aircraft carriers on TV. I just definitely wanted to see them, I mean, in person.
It was pretty exciting. I was excited to see it. So were my kids. I could tell they had their binoculars up and they were looking at all the ships and they were asking me what kinds they were.
But the ships weren't the only draw.
The turnout here was pretty amazing. I mean, obviously there's a lot of people here that respect what they do and, you know, just really want to know more about, you know, the daily lives of a sailor.
And learning about sailors is what local residents did when they toured USS Constellation. More than 30,000 lined the city's Embarcadero for a chance to get a closer look at the aircraft carrier. And once aboard, they say the wait was worth it.
It's incredible. It's an amazing thing to see how all these things function together and everything has a purpose. I think it's important to see that it's people behind all the machines and armaments, that the Navy really is people. But I know that they're out there doing their job and that it really is important to us all.
I think it's important so that the public can see what the ships are like, what the personnel on the ships do. We hear so much about it on TV, or you hear about it, you know, in the different communications, but you don't actually get to see it, and it gives them the opportunity to be able to see what the military actually go through on a day-to-day basis.
And that sentiment made the sailors giving the tours feel appreciated.
It makes me feel a great deal of pride just because, you know, the people actually come out and they shake your hands and they tell you, you know, how great of a job you're doing and they appreciate what you're doing for them. And those are the type of things that make me feel good about being a sailor, being out to sea.
But the action wasn't limited to the peers. The Blue Angels took to the skies to wow the crowd with a demonstration of their skills.
They never cease to amaze me. I'm just awestruck. It just runs chills up you, and it's just amazing. I can't believe it. I'm totally afraid of airplanes, but they could take me up in the air any day.
After an air show, including their amazing acrobatics, the Blue Angels inspired even the youngest of spectators.
The Navy's cool.
From San Francisco, Chief Tom Cradell, Navy Marine Corps News.